clapping.
Oh, nice.
So welcome everybody. Our speaker today is Javier Cabré from the ICREA, I think would be the English pronunciation, and the University Politecnica de Catalunya in Barcelona. And he will talk about stable solutions to semilinear elliptic equations are smooth up to dimension 9. Please go ahead. Thanks for coming.
Thanks a lot, Armin, and thanks all the four organizers for the nice invitation, the opportunity to present this work. In fact, this is a joint work. As you see here, with Alessio Figali, Javier Rosoton, and Joaquim Serra, which, as you can find it in archive, it just appeared also 2020. Okay, and it's about a problem I worked for many years, as you will see. When I described the history, and it's about a very simple, very simple equation. In a way, it's the simplest, say, reaction diffusion equation that you see here: minus Laplace U equals f of u. So f is the nonlinearity, and we are studying this equation in a bounded, say, smooth domain of Rn. Of course, this equation is the Euler-Lagrange equation of an energy or an action, which is Dirichlet energy minus potential energy. And so capital F is a primitive of F. And for the moment, F is completely general, right? So the first variation of the energy is the equation. And then now you can look at the second variation, which is, of course, the first variation of the first variation. And therefore, it's a linearized equation to our nonlinear equation. So it is an operator, second order, minus Laplace, and then minus a zero order term, f prime of u, at the solution u. All right. And then if we look, for instance, at local minimizers, for small perturbations, the second variation is going to be non-negative. And therefore, this means that this operator, in several senses, you can give several senses, variational, non-variational, to when an operator is non-negative definite. In the variational world, it comes up to be equivalent to a quadratic form, of course, the quadratic form associated to be non-negative. And this means that for every test function xi, it's going to be as smooth as you want and with compact support, or it would suffice zero on the boundary of omega. We will have this relation. The zero order part, same, will be controlled by the Dirichlet energy of the test function xi. Okay, and this is the definition of stable solution. So we will say that the solution u is stable if it is a solution and if the second variation is not negative. That is, we have this. So from now on, we will have in our hands two things mainly, and we have to play with them: the equation and the stability condition, which is this one. Okay, two remarks. Note that I didn't prescribe boundary values. If you want, the boundary values that I'm prescribing, like in minimal surfaces, in the plateau problem, are the boundary values given by the solution itself. Why is this? Because here, when I'm playing this game of being minimizer or not being minimizer, we are playing this game as in minimal surfaces when all the competitors have the same boundary values as you, because xi had compact support. So this is the game. Let us not touch the boundary values, say. But we do not care about them. First, we will care about interior estimates. The boundary values will not be important. Nonlinearities. Which kind of nonlinearities we have in mind for the problems that I will mention next? Well, bad nonlinearities, bad in the sense that bad for a priori estimates, for regularity, or say reactive nonlinearities, which means that they are going to be reacting. So this means a sign for F, and quite strongly, they are going to be they are going to grow more than linear at plus infinity, so it will be a superlinear problem. First remark, in this situation, there is no absolute minimizer of the energy because, and this is a difference with the plateau problem, say, for minimal surfaces, because, the Dirichlet energy grows quadratically, and since small f is superlinear at infinity, capital F is bigger than quadratic. It has a minus in front, so the functional is unbounded below. You see it here in red, it's unbounded below, so no absolute minimizer exists. So we have to answer the question, does it make the sense? Can there be local minimizers, stable solutions? And this is the case, and I think it's next transparency, yes. So I should show you cases where, interesting cases where there are stable solutions or local minimizers. And this is, arises from a model in combustion theory that was raised by Galfan back in 1963. And it is just the same problem, but put a parameter in front of the nonlinearity, lambda, positive parameter, and take the simplest boundary value, zero. So, lambda is positive, F is positive, the solution will be positive. So this I wrote here, but it is a consequence. And the assumptions we are going to make in 2F is that F is positive, even at U equals zero, non-decreasing, convex, and superlinear at plus infinity. These are some nice class where things that I will mention now apply, and that it comes back, it dates back these assumptions from those years or the 70s, okay? Non-decreasing, convex, superlinear at plus infinity. Model nonlinearity is the exponential, which is the one in Galfan's problem that is like the Arrhenius. It comes from combustion theory, the Arrhenius law in combustion kinetics, right? Other nonlinearities could be the powers, superlinear, huh? Superlinear. I don't, the power, not the pure power, but one plus u to the power p, because I want this f of zero bigger than zero. Why I want this? Well, one reason, say, is that then zero is not a solution of the problem, you see? Zero is not a solution because the right-hand side is strictly positive. So there is no trivial solution a priori of the problem. But one can prove with when lambda equals zero, zero is a solution. So one can start the implicit function theorem first and then do some more analysis, but this is not difficult, and prove that there is an extremal parameter, lambda star, finite, such that we call it like this, lambda star, we call it extremal parameter. And for every lambda less than lambda star, there is in fact a solution, which is the smallest possible positive solution. It plays like the role like of the zero solution for some other problems. It is the smallest possible one. It is classical, so bounded. By the way, when a solution is bounded, it is infinity, automatically, if f is infinity, right? Because if u is bounded, the right-hand side is bounded. You look at it then as a linear problem. You apply Calderon-Zygmund Schauder theory, and you keep increasing on the regularity of the solution. And if f is infinity, you get u is infinity. So the real deal is for regularity in these problems is the solution bounded or not, right? And for lambda less than lambda star, this smallest solution is classical, which means smooth, bounded, stable, and moreover, stable, all right? Good. And the branch is increasing. As lambda increases, this branch, by being the smallest solution, it's increasing, and increases to a function, u star, that one can prove with these assumptions on the nonlinearity, nothing else, one can prove that it's an L1 function, and it is a distributional solution for the extremal problem. And we call it the extremal solution of the Galfan problem of the Barenblatt-Galfan problem. Gelfand problem, usually one understands that it's exponential. So this would be generalized Gelfand problem. Okay, but at the moment, the only information that you can get in general easily is that it is in L1. So you can get a priori L1 bounds for these smooth solutions, and they pass to the limit by monotone convergence, nothing else. But it is really a distributional solution, and the stability condition will also, by monotone convergence, will go to the limit. So you can also think, if you want, that your study is stable, okay, even if it's a distributional solution. And then Yuan can prove that for lambda bigger than lambda star, there are no solutions. First, you prove that there are no classical solutions, and then with more sophisticated methods, not so easy, you can even prove that there are no solutions in distributional sense, very weak senses. And this was done, in fact, in the... Okay, let me mention this after. Let's go chronologically. After 1963, there is the work of Joseph and Landgren, 72, where they studied the radial case and for the exponential nonlinearity using ODE techniques, of course, because the solutions will be radially symmetric, and you have an ODE in front of you. And what they saw is that depending on the dimension, the picture of what happened, say, for instance, for the extremal solution is different. And up to dimension 9, let's forget dimension 2, up to dimension 9, it turns out that the extremal solution is bounded in the unit ball and for the exponential. And in higher dimensions, it is unbounded, okay? And this is the question that we care. Is it bounded or not? So is it regular or not, say? This was proved by ODE techniques, but at least I can give you a PDE, easy PDE argument to see where the dimension comes in. And the fact is like that in minimal surfaces, there is an explicit singular solution, which is the Simons cone or the Lawson cones. Here that we also have a similar object, which is an explicit singular solution, and it's a logarithm. Minus the logarithm, it vanishes on the boundary. It's a positive function. It's in the energy space, H1. And you compute, and you see that it solves the Gelfand problem for this parameter, in the unit ball, in dimension 3 and higher. So in all dimensions, it is an explicit singular solution. And then you wonder yourself, is it stable or not? Pretty much to know if it is connected to the branch of smaller solutions, or perhaps not, and it's somewhere up here, right? So let's just look at the linear to see if it's stable or not. So you do the linearized operator. Of course, it's the Laplace and then exponential of u, but the exponential of this function is 1 over x squared. And then this is a Hardy type operator. Of course, it's very simple to know if it's positive definite or not, because the two terms rescale the same. And the answer is going to be, the solution will be stable if this constant is not larger than the Hardy constant. And then you make the algebra here, you see, and you get n greater or equal than 10. So the singular solution is stable in dimensions 10 and higher. Like the Simons cone is a stable minimal surface in dimensions 8 and higher. And therefore, being stable, it has chances, and at the end it's true, it is the limit of the branch of minimal or smaller solutions. And therefore, this function is the U star, the extremal solution, in dimensions 10 and higher. Instead, in these dimensions, it's up here. It is very unstable. It has Morse index plus infinity. And instead, the extremal solution is bounded. Okay. So this is the first time when the dimension comes in this problem. And Joseph and Landgren also did the same analysis for the powers, and the same things happen, and the dimension is always also larger than 10 or 11, depending on the power p, where these are the dimensions in which you see an explicit singular, you see a singular stable solution, only in high dimensions, right? Okay, so the question is, when is extremal solution bounded and therefore regular? Or more generally, when are stable solutions bounded? Yeah, this is written here. Let me make a remark first. Okay, if we just care about general solutions, not necessarily stable, L-infinity estimates are very hard to prove for most nonlinearities. I mean, in general, L-infinity estimates for these reaction diffusion equations are only available for nonlinearities which are of power growth, not more than a power, and moreover, the power subcritical or at most critical, okay? So for general solutions, L-infinity estimates require this pretty much require this. And unless for some specific cases where maybe you have a certain boundary condition, a certain nonlinearity, a certain type of domain, but very particular cases. Otherwise, you need this. Instead, here we are wondering about very general class of nonlinearities, reactive nonlinearities, but we are adding this information of stability of the solution, right? And of course, this is the PD, it's a PD analog of the problem of regularity of stable minimal surfaces embedded in Rn, right? And what is known about this is that it is not true in dimension 8 and higher, and the Simons cone is the simplest counterexample. It is known that it's true for two-dimensional surfaces in R3, Fischer, Colbury, and Chen, and 1980, and independently by the Carmon and Penn, same time. And surprisingly or amazingly, the problem is still open in dimension 4 to 7, right? And it's a very famous problem. Of course, if you add information that the surface is not only stable, but it is a minimizing minimal surface, so an absolute minimizer of area with its own boundary values, then of course it is known up to the optimal dimensions, which is seven. So replacing minimality, being a minimizer, by stability, it turns out to be very to change the problem very much and to make it much more difficult, right? So let's go back to our problem. And the Joseph Landgren paper was in the unit ball, so radial case. Let's go to the first result in non-radial case. And this is a nice, very nice paper of Randall Rabinowitz from 75. And what they prove, among other things, what they prove is that the extremal solution is going to be bounded up to the optimal dimension 9 for the exponential and for the powers in any domain. Or even they have a condition that the nonlinearity is not the exponential, but looks very much like it. And the first derivative and the second derivative of f also should look like the exponential. And here, like the corresponding powers, first derivatives and second derivatives. So it's a quite strong, very strong condition, say, forcing f to be very close to an exponential or to a power. All right. But anyway, this is very nice, in the sense that it applies to any geometry for the domain. Okay, and then there were many years where there was no significant progress. And in the mid-90s, Chaim Brezis got interested again in this problem because of the parabolic version, which is in fact the real modeling problem for temperatures and reacting mixtures. What happens as time goes by? Say, pretty much is well. Will there be ignition of the reactive mixture or no ignition? And this will depend if lambda is less than lambda star or larger than lambda star. And in mid-90s, Brezis and his group in Paris 6 proved very nice things, like what I told you before, the non-existence of very weak solutions, even distributional solutions, for parameters larger than the extremal one, which is a delicate result. And at that time, I was a postdoc at Paris 6, working with in the group of Brezis and Berestiki, and I got really interested about the problem. They made some progress, but many questions remained open, and Brezis wrote them in several papers. One question to keep in mind, but I will not focus so much on this to center ideas, is that you can also wonder if the extremal solution is in the energy space or not, which is an interesting question. Besides being bounded or unbounded, is it in the energy space? But what I will care more is about this other question, that is what I've been talking about up to now, the boundedness of the extremal solution or the extreme or the stable solutions more generally. And Brezis wrote literally in a paper, or almost literally, is there something sacred about dimension 10? Or is it possible to construct a singular stable solution in low dimensions, say less than 9, for some domain and some nonlinearity? So at that point, still, we were doubting about the answer. So now let me tell you about the progress that was made up to now, up to the work with Alessio, Joachim, and Javier. The first paper was by a PhD student of Brezis, Grégoire Nedef, 2000. And he proved a very nice result. It was not easy to prove that stable solutions are in fact bounded. For every nonlinearity F of the type that I show you, positive, increasing, convex, superlinear at infinity, up to dimension 3. So this was, let's focus on the L infinity bound, and for the moment, let me forget about the H1. I will say something about H1 later. That was nice. And then some years later, well, 5 years later, I succeeded with Antonio Capella to prove that the extremal solution in the radial case, the extremal solution is bounded up to the optimal dimension 9 for every nonlinearity F as before, or even we don't have any assumption on F if you just look at the a priori estimate. No assumption at all. So this was nice, and this, at least to me, it made me think that the result should be true. Yes, right. Should be true. By the way, for these type of equations, we don't have like classification results saying if you have an isolated singularity, it will behave like the solution around it. It will behave like radial, right? Something that you know for harmonic functions that explode, or for some other equations. In this generality of this large class of nonlinearities. Reactive nonlinearities, we don't have theorems like that. But still, I thought, okay, isolated singularities should look like radial, and this is telling me that there shouldn't be. So I believed in the result, in the positive result, that 9 is the right dimension. And some years later, I was able to prove it up to dimension 4. The interior bound doesn't care about the convexity of the domain. The important thing is that I could include all nonlinearities F, not even those that are superlinear. The a priori estimate is completely universal. It's completely independent of F. And okay, after this, there were some more tries and partial results. I involved some people that I thought it could be very useful, like Joel Sprague, for instance, or some other people, but we didn't succeed. We succeed to get some results, but under strong assumptions on the domain. Double revolution means like doubly radial. Well, let me not waste time on this, or assumptions still on the nonlinearity and its derivatives, right? So it was, well, maybe 10 years later, and now I'm presenting the results with Figali, Rosatona, and Serra. This is the main theorem. It's the interior estimate, okay? It's interior estimate, and says that if you have let's just look at the a priori estimate. So suppose the solution is smooth and it's stable. And the only assumption, but it's in the unit ball, because I'm going to state this as an a priori estimate, but the solution is non-radial, of course. And the only assumption we need is that the nonlinearity is the nonlinearity to be non-negative. Only thing. And what we prove is that second thing, for instance, up to dimension 9, the solution is bounded, the stable solution, also every stable solution is going to be bounded and even holder, continuous, and with a beautiful estimate, which is linear. And on the right-hand side, it has a very weak norm, the weakest possible norm, say, for a solution, the L1 norm, in a larger ball, B1 half, B1. And this is a constant that it depends only on the dimension, right? So it looks like a linear estimate, like in Gilbert Schrödinger, say, right, for a nonlinear problem. But this class of stable solution allows you to enter into some arguments and some arguments that at the end look like linear. And this you can see in our paper or in the proofs, if I have some time for the proofs, okay? We are also able to prove the energy estimate, even a little more, but say the energy estimate in every dimension, which was another open problem, okay?
So,
yes.
You said there's no assumption on F, but F is still smooth or something and has some.
Okay, say to give sense to F prime, I think in the paper we assume that F is locally Lipschitz or local Lipschitz or something like this. Yes. Yeah. If it has jumps, maybe we can also have some results for some nonlinearities with jumps. I'm not totally sure now. I should look. Okay, yeah, I care about smooth nonlinearities, but of any shape, say. This is an interior estimate, but it has a nice consequence, which is a global estimate in convex domains. When the domain is convex, it is known that singularities, for these problems, it is known that singularities cannot be close to the boundary. And this is done with, this is a consequence of the moving planes method. If the domain is convex, you can start the moving planes method and prove that the solution from the boundary starts increasing. And it cannot have really a singularity or a bunch of points converging to the boundary and blowing up, no. So this moving planes method combined with interior estimate, it gives global estimates in convex domains. But of course, we cared about more general domains and a global estimate. So this is the second part of the paper. It's a boundary regularity. And what we need is the domain to be C3. And we need more things for the nonlinearity. We need the nonlinearity to be non-negative, non-decreasing, and convex. And then if you have a stable solution of the Dirichlet problem, we only do the zero boundary conditions to start with. Then you have the same type of estimates, but now up to the boundary, the L infinity estimate and the holder estimate, of course, up to dimension 9 only. And the estimate still looks linear and the constant depends only on the domain. So very nice, very clean. Corollary, the extremal solution is always bounded up to dimension 9. The extremal solution in every dimension is in the energy space. And some other theorems, but I will not enter it, go to treat the case of dimensions higher. Stable solutions can be singular. And what we prove are some Morey type estimates or Lebesgue type, Morey type estimates for stable singular solutions. Okay. All right. Let me just say, interrupt me whenever you want, please. No problem at all. Related work. Okay, the Pilaplacian is an interesting test, another test class of equations, and here I made a mistake here in the slides. I should be just p bigger than one. When you write the Pilaplace, you wonder about p bigger than one. And I could, with some collaborators, Pietro Miraglio, Manuel Sanchon, we could prove after the work with, of course, following the ideas in the previous work, we could prove the optimal result for p bigger than 2. And one has regularity of stable solutions up to a dimension that depends on p, okay? Depends on on p. And for p between 1 and 2, the optimal, we have a result, but it's not optimal. The optimal dimension that we believe that we know which one should be, because for the exponential, the radial case, everything has been proved, it's still open for general nonlinearities. And another interesting class, I'm interested on this, Armin is also interested on this, are fractional diffusion problems. So you replace the Brownian diffusion by Levy diffusion, you have the fractional Laplace here on the right-hand side, and you ask yourself the same. And let me say here that the optimal dimensions that now for regularity of stable solutions, that now will, the optimal dimensions will depend on the fraction S, are open. The result is open even in the radial in the radial case. The optimal dimensions are what we believe are the optimal dimensions. Is an involved relation on gamma, several gamma functions of N and S. It's quite involved, the relation. But for some reasons, we know that we believe that because there is an explicit singular solution, we believe it should be the optimal. And it is only known for the exponential nonlinearity in convex symmetric domains. And this is a beautiful paper of Javier Rosaton from 1914. Okay, so even in the radial case, the fractional Laplacian is still open. So in the rest of the time, which is not too much, but it's okay, but it's good enough, I will describe a little the proofs, at least for the interior regularity. The boundary regularity follows the same lines, but it's more complicated. There is a difficulty. If I have time at the end, I will mention an important difficulty. For the interior, okay, so we have the equation, we have the linearized operator that has a sign, which is this condition, the stability condition. And then the proof starts doing a trick that I already did in previous papers, that is writing the stability condition in another way, in this way here, that comes simply from doing something abstract in principle, but it's not abstract. It's like, let me call the test function psi to be, let me take it to be the product of two functions, where the crucial one will be this function C that I will try to choose later appropriately. And eta, let's say, will be less important. C will not vanish on the boundary, and therefore I will need to take eta vanishing on the boundary. And then if you plug this on the stability and you integrate by parts, this is just integration by parts, what you will see on the right-hand side is Dirichlet energy for eta, but weighted by C square. And on the left-hand side, you will see the linearized operator acting on C. Okay, and now the game is to try to choose appropriate C that satisfies something like nice for the linearized operator. This idea that I made in a previous paper, the paper that I reached dimension 4, and the radial, no, also the radial paper, I got it motivated, say, by the Simon's lemma on minimal cons, because in Simon's proof, you do the same. And the function C turns out to be the length of the second fundamental form. So the square root of the sum of the squares of all the principal curvatures to the surface, which satisfies, of course, something nice for the Jacobi operator. The Jacobi operator is the linearized operator in minimal surfaces, okay? Okay, so this was the idea. I recall here now what we have in hands. I mean, what we have available, the information we have available is stability written for C and eta, okay? And now let me tell you in the previous works which test functions Xi were taken. In the Crandall-Rabinowitz paper for the exponential nonlinearity and the Nedev paper that went up to dimension 3 for all many nonlinearities, they didn't do this trick. There is no choice of C. And what they took as test function was a nonlinear function of U, of the solution. And the nonlinearity to be chosen appropriately depending on the nonlinearity F of the original problem. So this was their test function. In the radial case, instead, we took this structure of a test function, a product of two of them, and the crucial one, C, was the radial derivative of the solution. Or you can take UR, or you can take RUR, doesn't matter, because you incorporate the rest on eta. So you think of the radial and the radial. And the idea was natural, because if you have, in the radial case, if you have u solves the equation, which is an ODE, and it's natural that when you differentiate the ODE with respect to R, well, you will get an equation for satisfied by UR that will be related to the linearized operator, because f of u will become f prime of u times UR. So this was the right choice. Of course, in the non-radial case, RUR is the same as x grad u, x times grad u. And this was the right choice in the radial case because it goes up to the optimal dimension 9. And the other function eta is the same type as in Simon's lemma for minimal cones, which is a power of the distance to the origin, a negative power of the distance to the origin. And then, a cutoff near the boundary, but this cutoff is not important, okay? Instead, in my paper that succeeded to include dimension 4, my test function was completely different. Was the modulus of the gradient. Instead of the radial derivative, the full gradient. And then the eta was a function of u. All right, so let me say that at the end, in the paper with Figali, Rosaton, and Serra, we will need both. In fact, we will need both, okay? So we will need both. Okay. I guess I have 50 minutes. Is it okay? Or you prefer 45? Or what do you prefer?
10 to 15, let's say.
Sorry?
10 to 15. Between 10 and 15.
I don't understand. The time that I have left, you mean?
Yes. You have between 10 and 15 minutes.
So. Okay. I will be done at 10 to 8. Yeah. Okay, great. Thanks, Armin. Okay, we will need both. So the first thing you have to do is to compute the linearized operator on both of them. And the first one is super simple computation, and you get twice the Laplacian. And for the gradient of u, you also, it's an easy computation, and you get the Hessian square minus a column in the normal direction to the level sets. The full Hessian square minus the last column, okay? And in fact, this is more geometric. Inside this quantity, there is information on the curvature of the level sets of the solution. And my paper up to dimension 4 use this test function, consider the level sets through the Coaria formula, and apply a beautiful, strong, powerful geometric analysis, Sobolev inequality, that you probably all know better than me, the Michael-Simon Sobolev inequality on the level sets, on each level set of the solution. So I think it's a quite nice proof, and it has geometric flavor because curvatures appear, but it allows only to go to update dimension 4. And then some years later, I think it was like 2013 or 14, I came back to this other test function, x grad u, and I made a computation with this, and I was able to do the radial computation, but in the non-radial case. And I was able to, that I will show you now the computation, was able to arrive to dimension 9, some information up to dimension 9, that was very strong, and led to almost the L-infinity estimate, but not really. A BMO, bounded mean oscillation estimate for stable solutions up to dimension 9. BMO means bounded mean oscillation. Well, you all probably know what it is, but let me say, for instance, that it implies that the solution is in every Lebesgue space, in LP for every P. But it doesn't give really L-infinity. And okay, these were 2013, and for 7 years, I was not able to complete the program and get the L-infinity estimate. I mentioned the problem and I described my proof of the BMO estimate to some experts, say that I thought could help and that I trusted, say, because I never brought the proof. And then we didn't succeed. And in two visits to Zurich, Xavier Rosatón and Joachim Serra were PhD students of me, and they knew well my progress. They had thought about it. And going to Zurich to visit them and Alessio, I told Alessio the problem. He didn't know this problem and my progress. And he really got caught into it. We worked hard for a week. We couldn't get the result. Came back to Barcelona, and maybe a year later, second visit to Zurich, I insisted to try the four of us because we needed as much power as possible. And after some days, we could get the result. So in the remaining time, let me show you how the proof goes and what is this computation. The computation, I told you what is the computation, is to take x grad u as c, and then I don't care about eta now. And on the stability inequality, what you get is the c function, x grad u, times the linearized operator acting on it, which gives me, which is simply 2 Laplace u times the test function eta squared. And now when you do this, you do here, you can do some things. You can say Laplace of u is f of u. And you could do some things, but this doesn't really lead to something nice. The idea I had is to keep the Laplace. These are second derivatives. Let me go back to the stability. On the right-hand side, what you will have is c squared, x grad u squared. So just first derivatives, and then gradient eta. So first derivatives squared. So this is not so nice, second derivatives, but you can do the Pogosyev trick in the Pogosyev identity and integrate by parts this and get rid of second derivatives and just remain come up to a relation for first derivatives. And the relation is this after the Pogosyev trick. There are three terms. One of them involves the gradient of u squared. The other term involves the radial derivative ur times the radial derivative ur, because later I will take eta to be radial. And then the third, also the radial derivative ur. Okay, so the zero term is the most powerful one. So this parenthesis here better be positive, because if it's negative, I will have it on the right-hand side, and the radial derivative is less, is weaker than the full derivative. So let's choose eta as a power, like in Simon's lemma, a power, and take the most possible, the most negative possible exponent to make zero non-negative. And this is this exponent. You take it, and then you put it on the one and two term. And you put it on the one and two term, and you will get the radial derivative square, yes, and here also. And you have to compare this gradient of eta square and gradient of eta squared. And the computation is very simple, and in front of the radial derivative square, in front of the radial, you see here, radial derivative square in front, you get these two terms, one and two, contribute with some numbers, but you make the algebra, and it turns out to be n minus 2 times 10 minus n. So this was very good news, because this means that you get some information only in the right dimensions, from 3 to 9. And this gave, this told that this computation is the correct one. And the good thing is that on the left-hand side, you get this quantity here, ur square x to the 10 to minus n. And look, it's beautiful because it's rescale invariant, like the L-infinity norm, that's what I'm looking for. Why it's rescale invariant? Well, you see it, right? Two derivatives squared, so it's dimension minus two, This 2 kills this minus 2. And then the minus n takes care of the Lebesgue measure. And so this is scale invariant. So this good. This means that I'm on the right scaling for L infinity or BMO estimates. And on the right hand side, you get terms coming from the error, the cutoff that I told you. It's not important. Yeah, no, it's not important, of course, but it will come up at the end. And this cutoff will be one in the ball, in the full ball. But then I will have to die. It will die. So its gradient, it will concentrate it in an annulus, b to rho minus b rho. And then you get the same quantity, but not with the radial derivative, but with the full gradient, because zero also contributes, because zero contributes with this differentiation of theta. If we had here u r squared, we would be done. And we would have the Holder estimate and the L infinity estimate right away, because this is the whole, the what is called the hole filling technique in PDs. Well, in analysis, you probably have seen this. You just from this, you bring the ball of radius rho to the other side, and what you see is that this quantity in the ball of radius rho is going to be strictly less with a constant less than one multiplying at the same quantity in the ball of radius 2 rho. So you get geometric decay for this quantity, and this geometric decay with respect to rho, it gives you Holder continuity. That's classical, okay? That's Gilbert Schrödinger's saying. But the difficulty, and for 7 years we were stuck, is that on the left-hand side, there is the full gradient instead of the radial derivative. Okay. This I already, on the other hand, a BMO estimate is not difficult to get, just knowing that these quantities are bounded and moving the center. I spoke about radial derivative with respect to a point, but this point has nothing particular. Solutions are not radial, so I can move the point. Moving the point, it's easy to see that you arrive to BMO by Poincaré inequality. This is very easy. So if we have this. If we had that in an annulus, the weighted, well, it's not so important weighted because the weight will go out of the integral because I'm in an annulus. If we had in an annulus that the gradient square of a stable solution can be controlled by the radial derivative, then we would be done because of what I said before, Hall-filling technique. So this is the right question. Next slide, and I will finish in some 2 minutes. May this be true? And the progress came from an observation that was, well, suppose that we're like in a linear problem when you try to prove Sobolev inequality or Poincaré inequality by compactness. And the problem is linear. Suppose it's false. In the extreme case, I would have a function that makes the right-hand side zero and the left-hand side one. Okay, we see proofs like this by compactness. But if the right-hand side is zero, u r is zero in the annulus, u is zero homogeneous. And therefore, you have a superharmonic function, and here is the point, one of the crucial points where we use that the nonlinearity is non-negative. You would have a superharmonic function on the sphere because it's an homogeneous, a zero homogeneous function. But we know that there are no superharmonic functions on the spheres, but constants. But then if u is constant, this is a contradiction. This was what gave us hope for the whole thing. And then let me say that that the proof of this in the paper is done by compactness argument, So the nonlinearity is going to change. You will have a family of nonlinearities, a family of stable solutions. And to carry on the compactness argument, what we need is a higher integrability to get compactness, a higher integrability result for the gradient in L2. We need that the gradient is a little more than L2. Gamma is positive. And this is proved using the other test function in the stability inequality, the modulus of the gradient, that gives some curvature estimates on the level sets. And these say through the Michael-Simon, we don't use the Michael-Simon, but I told them when we were working, I told them, don't worry, we can use the Michael-Simon first. It should give more integrability for the gradient through the Coaria formula and the level sets and the Michael-Simon Sobolev inequality. So here is where we use the other test function. And I think this is what I wanted to tell. Well, let me just say that now I have a proof that does not use compactness. I'm writing this, okay? Soon it will be in archive. In September will be in archive. I have a proof which is totally nice in the sense quantitative, and you can quantify all the constants, and it doesn't use compactness. But this is a nice proof, the compactness, because it also allows for sometimes it is possible that for some other problems like the Pilaplacian or something like this, the compactness proof may be more flexible than my quantitative. I still don't know, because I'm just doing this for the Laplace operator. In the boundary regularity, there is a point when things change. That is, there are super harmonic functions which are zero homogeneous in half a sphere. In half a sphere, the angle, for instance, the angle in dimension two, it's a super harmonic function that vanishes on the boundary, and in half the sphere there are non-constant super harmonic functions on the sphere. But there is another obstruction. If U is zero homogeneous, Laplace of U is going to be minus two homogeneous. F of U still is zero homogeneous, the equation should not be satisfied. And therefore, in the boundary regularity, the main theorem is that we need to pass to the limit to this equation. So still we use a compactness argument, but we need to really say that the limit satisfies an equation like this. And this is much more difficult, and it's a very nice theorem. And then it's when we require F to be increasing and convex. Okay, so I just gave you a flavor of this. It's like a theorem in complex analysis about completeness of harmonic functions, right? A compactness, the class of stable solutions is closed, right? So sorry for the extra minutes, and yeah, sorry. I mean, I couldn't make it. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much. Clapping doesn't work, so I clap.
Oh, thank you.
Questions, remarks, thank comments.
Thank you.
Maybe I can start. So I wasn't sure when you mentioned the Porzhaev trick. How more general could you choose the Laplacian? I mean, like an elliptic operator, would this destroy everything immediately, or is it like a trick to?
Well, one of my PhD students now is doing this, trying to do all this stuff for instead of Laplace, a second order operator. Aij of x, dij, plus first order terms. And of course, assuming smooth coefficients, things I think will work up at the will work at the end. But it is not totally trivial, because in all this game there are these radial derivatives, which is very much connected to the Laplace. Because if my operators, if my coefficients are general, the radial thing doesn't make so much sense. But still localizing, I think everything will work up, at least the interior and the interior estimates. But this is being done in progress, a work in progress. But it should be okay. The boundary, we will see the boundary.
All right. I have one more question.
Sure.
So you mentioned that you could get this BMO version or the BMO regularity before.
Yes.
And so that would mean that once you have BMO and you know this nonlinearity is like at most exponential, then you...
Yes.
Done, right? Only...
Yes, exactly. Exactly, exactly. In the... Yes. With the BMO, if you... I could allow any nonlinearity which grows at most like exponentially, or maybe I could even... I kind of remember I could deal with exponential of U squared. Like in the Schrödinger, exponential of U squared. But the exponential of the exponential of U nonlinearity, say, I couldn't reach. Say.
All right, Gurfan, a question?
Yeah. Hello. So really nice talk. Thanks a lot. So I may ask a question. So this method, can you give some idea for the the stable minimum surface, this problem. So you mentioned that at the beginning.
Yes. Does it give some idea?
So I tried, good choice of the test function, for example.
Yeah. I tried a little, but it's not so easy. But what did I try? Well, I tried something I mentioned to some of you before the seminar. Which is, for instance, let's forget now about minimal cones and things like and general minimal surfaces, but let's focus, say, to make it more similar to this, let's focus on minimal graphs, right? Minimal graphs where you have a function satisfying a PDE, like here. And what you would like to do, I mean, one thing that would be nice that does not exist, I believe, is to prove the classification theorem for minimal graphs that says every entire minimal graph embedded in Rn, if n is less or equal than 8, is flat. Okay, is flat. And this is proved through monotonicity formula, blowdown, Simon's theorem on cones, etc. You get out of the world of graphs. Right. So can one prove this using something similar to this? I would say that this is the first thing that at least to me came to my mind.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Okay, try, please. I tried a little, but okay. The minimal graphs equation is a kind of is kind of delicate, okay? And soon you get many, many terms, okay? You get many, many terms. And I was not able, but perhaps, I don't know, but I was not able. I'm not,
okay.
Perhaps I would say that there are not so many chances, but okay, perhaps that would be very nice, I think. Well, I would like it a lot to see.
Okay, thanks. Thank you very much.
Sure. Thanks to you for the question.
Follow up on that with a question.
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah. Sorry, let me glow a little bit more. Thanks for the talk, by the way. Great talk.
Thanks, Rob. Thanks.
On the minimal graphs case, I mean, if you didn't want to do entire graphs, I was trying to understand what omegas you're really allowing. I thought you were taking like bounded domains and making.
Yeah, sure.
In the minimal graphs case, if you've got like a big, like if the domain contains like a half space or something, there might be something nice.
Yeah.
Graphs case and get some more structures there. I have a question that's related. You mentioned the method of moving planes and the possibility of understanding something about isolated singularities. Joel Spruch obviously is, but so could you come back to that a little bit and just
sure.
I real fast and I know you're doing the ODE case then, but what is going on there with like isolate? Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
No, but tell me. What is the question precisely?
Well, I just trying to understand. I wasn't sure about it. In certain dimensions, there are possibilities that you would have isolated singularities or hole-like singularities. That's what I was trying to just understand. What might?
Oh, I see. The simplest one is an isolated singularity, and it is given by this by this function here, the logarithm.
Right.
And turns out to satisfy a Semlinian equation for the exponential. Another one you could consider is simply a power, not the logarithm, but a negative power of mod x. And then it satisfies exactly an equation for the power nonlinearities. And then you look when are they stable? When are they stable? And they turn out to be stable in high dimensions, like the Simon's cone, right? Of course, you can plug, for instance, suppose that you take this function in R2 and you plug it in R3.
Right.
And then it has a line singularity, or I could make a plane singularity. Sure.
So in high enough dimensions, you get isolated singularities. What about kind of solutions that glue together those? That's sort of like a bridge.
Oh, the gluing.
Well, not necessarily by gluing, but just some graphically. Just is it multiple isolated singularities? Multiple.
Yes. This has been done for these kind of semilinear equations for some nonlinearities. This is work of, it comes first, probably the first results were by Frank Packard. Okay. Yeah. Frank Packard. Taking the ideas of from differential geometry, the gluing of differential geometry with this the Greek guy
Kapouleas,
and he did this for the power for the exponential nonlinearity. Then it was done for the powers. For the critical exponent, there are many works where you have the bubbles because it's a geometric problem in harmonic maps, right? And you have the bubbles and you can glue them together. So surely for this type of equations I'm considering, there could be multiple singularities, yes. And as I was telling you, there is no result that says that for general nonlinearities that says every singularity will be
so asked how to be radial.
Exactly, or in a line or something like this.
Yeah.
There is nothing like this.
That's what I was aiming at. Let me ask one more thing because I'm monopolizing and I can ask more later. Sure. So you mentioned Fisher-Kolbery and Shane, and of course Fisher-Kolbery's work again is like if you have multiple ends, stable might be replaced by something like finite index, if that has a meaning. I mean, by sort of cutting away stuff.
Sure.
Is there? I mean, presumably there's some way to deal with
finite mode index. Yeah, it is a little more delicate, but at the end, one knows things. Let me just say, to be fair, for semilinear problems, the Morse index first important, very important work was by Bari, Abbas Bari, Rutgers, and Pierre-Louis Lyons. And there are other papers, mostly for the exponential and power nonlinearities. Let me say that for the exponential and power nonlinearities, you have a monotonicity formula, like in minimal surfaces. But for some other nonlinearities, well, there is a monotonicity formula of Modica, but it's not precise enough. It's not, you get a monotone quantity, but the remainders, are not precise enough. So, but now the work I described today, you will find it's a perfect, very nice generalization by Figali and Wang. I don't remember the first name, in archive, very recent, some weeks ago. Okay. And they are able to prove for finite Morse index, to prove things like that the singularities are isolated, if I remember well, and that about up to dimension 9 as universal, you cannot hope for it. You cannot hope for it. Okay, but there are some results. I don't know. I still don't know them precisely to be able to tell you.
Thanks. Good to get an idea of what the ground looks like. Thank you.
Sure, thanks.
All right, Jonas?
Firstly, thank you very much for this beautiful talk. I wanted to have just, it might be a very silly question, but a posteriori, would you say your choice of the test function stability, you have now a systematic way to look for it, or has it something to do with the range of the linearized operator, or could you phrase it as an additional PDE you want to solve?
Good question. Yeah, that would be nice if we could say, what I would like is to find a function that a C function that solves for this right hand side in the linearized equation. All right, I see. I never thought about this, and then be able to describe your C function quantitatively good enough. I never thought about this. Very interesting, Jonas. Let me tell you that what we have is all what we thought about. I mean, there are not so many more possibilities. I would say that in minimal surfaces also, maybe I'm wrong, correct me if I'm wrong, but also you do not have so many possibilities. But of course, there are other. For instance, instead of x grad u, I could go and take second derivatives. I don't know, xi, xj, uij, for instance. Why not second derivatives? Xi, xj, uij. I played around a little with this, but. Okay, there are open problems. Let me say that there is an analog of this problem for another more geometric problem, which is the Bernoulli problem in free boundaries, which is more geometric. Yeah, but it's what you have is a surface, right? Well, more geometric in the sense that there is a free boundary and it's a surface that you want to classify, and what you have is a harmonic functions on one side of the surface, harmonic functions, and then a Neumann condition that says the flux, the normal derivative, equals one everywhere on the surface. And here you have monotonicity formulas. You can do blow down, blow up, as in minimal surfaces, and you can reduce your problem to studying cones, okay? So you will have a cone, and on one side of the cone, you will have a harmonic function, and you will ask that its normal derivative on the cone to be one everywhere. And this is still an open, to classify cones is an open problem, okay? So it's been done up to dimension 4, and this is a really difficult, very nice paper by David Jerrison and Ovidiu Sabin. And there are content examples by Jerrison and Da Silva in dimension 7 or 8, I don't remember, perhaps 7, but still open dimension 5, 6, 7 are open, okay? And here, yeah, well, I'm throwing an idea. Here I tried, since you have no non-linearity F, that may help. And I tried a test function that nobody tried, xi, xj, uij, but didn't succeed. So, but I'm throwing this idea if somebody wants to try it, right? So, well, thanks for your suggestion, but we don't still have a machinery like this, so nicely.
Thank you very much.